Hi, this is Eric Nolan of the OJs. Check me out right now on Les Holmes' Stories of Music.
And hello, one and all, and welcome to another edition of Les Holmes Stories of Music. And you're in for a great treat today. You won't be disappointed. But before we get into the introduction, I want to send a shout out to my friends over at Never Stop Entertainment, Miss Miriam Graham. Thank you so very much. I appreciate you so very much. And also, this episode is being powered by Dare to Be Different 601 Apparel. So you want to check it out, just go to IG, Dare to Be Different 601. And without further ado, we have, I think they call him the man in the middle. He's none other. He's none other than Mr. Eric Nolan from the OJs. Man, how you doing?
I'm great.
Man, I'm so glad you took time out and to come and spend with little old me. It's a privilege. I saw you in person. I saved this for you. I saw you in person. Oh God, maybe about 3-4 years ago. You were in a little small town called Wharton, Texas. Mm. You're right down the road from Houston, not far from Sugar Land. And you were down there for a Juneteenth celebration. Mm-hmm. So I saw you. I didn't get to meet you, but I saw you. A good friend of mine introduced you guys, brought you guys up on stage. Don Sam, he's a Texas Radio Hall of Fame announcer here in Houston. But anyway, so man, what's going on with Mr. Eric Nolan? And the OJs. Well, what's going on with you? We'll talk about the OJs in a bit. What's going on with you?
Oh man, I'm all over the place, man. It's so many things that's going on, especially since COVID. Uh-huh. It's been trying. Let's use that word. It's been trying. Okay. It's been nip and tuck for us. I mean, especially when COVID first when Eddie and Walter was looking forward to retiring.
Okay.
In a couple of years, they wanted to retire, but we wanted to do one or two big tours before we left. Mm-hmm. And we were preparing for that. And then COVID hit and it just froze everything. So we kind of like, you know, first we heard 4 to 6 weeks and we can deal with that. Mm-hmm. Then we heard 3 to 4 months. Next thing you know, it's a year. Mm-hmm. And it just got. So it's got lengthy, man. And I love music and I love it so much. It's always been a part of my life since I was like 4 years old. Mm-hmm. So I've always did something that has something to do with music. And I think subconsciously I didn't know how I was going to deal with it. I just felt like I could because I felt like I was comfortable enough to not work for a while. Mm. So it wouldn't hurt me. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So as long as I felt like it wouldn't hurt me, I could deal with being off or I put it into my mind like I'm in hiatus or something. Okay. But I was kind of moonlighting a little bit by doing this little radio show. I had a little radio show I was doing out of Washington, D.C.
Okay.
On WHUR HD4 called Tens, the Eric Nolan Show. So I would do an hour. I would record an hour. I record like about four shows in the can, you know, go on the road, stuff like that. And I would come on right after Will Downing.
Okay.
So that was cool, just to get my feet wet, I like what you do. You know what I mean? I watch, you know, when you watch people like you do this kind of stuff. And, you know, my best friend is John Mason out of Detroit. And got Lynn Tolliver here in Cleveland. Those are more my mentors. And I just wanted to, that's like a secret passion of mine to do radio.
All right.
Okay. So now, fast forwarding, when it got to be, you know, when it got to be lengthy, we had a station here in Cleveland, 107.3 The Wave, and they went off the air in December of 19. So, and I'm all, like I said, I'm all over the place. I do a Eric Nolan thing. I've got a little solo project that I do. I've released about four or five records. And what happened was that station was very instrumental in putting out music for local artists here in Cleveland. So when that radio station went off the air, I kind of somewhat panicked. Like, I'm not going to be able to be heard. Cleveland's not going to know what I got out because, you know, when it comes to mainstream radio, like the ZAKs and 107.9, they're owned by corporations.
Right.
So that's a different type of thing. Whereas 107.3 was independently owned.
Yep.
So they make their own playlist and they do what they want to do.
Yeah.
And so they supported Eric Nolan and a lot of other artists, you know, the Kanye Dawses and Frederick and Frank McCombs. They supported all of us. Mm-hmm. And so when they went off the air, I kind of like, well, what am I going to do now? You know what I mean? What's going to happen now? So I went to it was a new station that was coming up that's in Cleveland. They were only 2 years old. And really nobody knew about them. I didn't even know about them. Mm-hmm. Someone told me about them. You know what I mean? And I went over there and I asked them and I said, I have a radio show out of DC. And I was wondering if I could come on once a week to, you know, be on your radio show, which my thought process was that way I can get some of the locals heard. I'll play them on my show. Mm-hmm. And so the guy said, I know who you are. And he was like, you can come once a week. You can come and do this once a week. When I got on the air, by the time I got off the air, he was like, can you do 3 days? You know what I mean?
Right.
He was like, can you do 3 days? So then I was like, yeah, I can do 3 days. That's good for me. Uh-huh. Right? That's good for me, right?
Right, right.
Because I can play local music.
Right.
So I abruptly stopped doing HUR. Like abruptly. Right. I got like next week, I'm done.
Just shut it down.
I have to because my heart was in Cleveland.
I got you.
Now, so I started doing that. Now, when COVID hit and the J's weren't working, that kind of filled a void for me musically because I was still able to play music. I was still able to interact with the audience. And I was able to, and I'm able to do some good for the community.
Right. Right.
As far as our locals being heard, because our locals have no way of being heard.
That's true.
So I created a platform called 15 Minutes of Fame. For a half an hour, I just play Cleveland music. Mm-hmm. But I got a 3-hour show, but for a half an hour, I play that.
Right, right.
And so that's what has been going on with me when I tell you I'm all over the place. Because I want to do OJ so bad, man. I just miss the stage so much. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I can't get to the stage. So that's frustrating to me that the three of us can't get to the stage. Not because of us, not because one of us is sick, not because somebody's on drugs, somebody ain't making a show, not because of any of that. It's because of COVID and what it has done to as far as the public coming to see concerts. So now I'm like, what do I do? So then this radio things just filled that void for me. And I'm still recording Eric Nolan stuff.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? So that's what I mean. I'm like, I'm trying to just keep busy musically so that I don't go crazy. You know what I mean? And so that's, hopefully I kind of answered your question.
You did.
Intricately, because I have so many mixed emotions right now. I have a lot of emotions. It's just like boiling over because I want to perform. I want to be on stage less. I want to be on stage so bad.
Yeah.
You know, and I can't get to the stage.
Let me ask you this. So, speaking of on the stage, when did you join the OJs?
1995.
Mm-hmm. So you've been with them for a minute.
25 years.
So what is it? How did that whole thing come about?
Well, fast forwarding, I'm gonna go from the beginning stage, but I'm gonna go do it real quickly. I had a group in Cleveland called the Deltones, and we was three of us, and we were more or less emulating the OJs, but we really thought we was gonna be the next OJs.
All right.
When the OJs fall off, we're gonna be there, fill that void. Mm-hmm. So everything I did was kind of OJ-ish. You know what I mean? From my shows to the wardrobe to how we did everything. Mm-hmm. Well, Gerald was about 15 at the time. And he came to we did an outdoor venue, and they opened up. And the crowd was so much in a frenzy of us coming there that they made Gerald, Mark, and Sean form a human chain to hold the girls back from rushing the limo, right? Okay. So okay. Gerald was always kind of like sort of intrigued like that. Like, who are these guys that's, you know, as popular as my dad, but we just as popular in Cleveland. In Cleveland, we had it on lock. You know what I mean? So we looked like the Jackson 5 when we came out. You know what I mean? It was that pandemonium. You got like 40,000 people there.
All right.
So Gerald and I became buddies. I used to go over to their house a lot. And I used to go over to their house a lot to kick it with Gerald. And, you know, I knew he liked our group. But they also had real milk. They also had cereal. They
also had real milk.
They had real milk. And they didn't have Carnation where we had to put water in it. So I'll go over there. I had breakfast with them because they used to eat good over there, man. And you know, Gerald was crazy about me, so I ate what they ate, you know what I mean?
Okay,
I was really over there. I was over there to do music, but I was over there to eat too. Yeah, I was over there to eat because my Levert, she put the pots on, she had no problem in cooking, you know what I mean? So, we formed a union, we formed a bond. I was over there so much. Mm-hmm. And nobody understood why I would be over there with this kid that was, you know, my junior, but he understood it back then. He understood the music world back then, and we just formed a bond. So Walter Williams of the OJs became our manager.
Okay,
he got us in with Gamblin' Huff and Bunny Sigler and those guys. Mm-hmm. So he flew us to Philly, and we started recording with them. So Gerald thought that we was about to be the next big thing out of Cleveland behind the Daz Band. He thought we was about to blow up because we were Gamblin' Huff and Bunny Sigler, right?
Right, right.
So we made a union. Gerald being slick, we formed a union saying whoever make it first, get the other one in the door. Right. Mm-hmm. So we formed that bond, and. Years later, Levert got the record deal at Atlantic.
Okay.
We got sat on the shelf. They sat our group on the shelf. We had cut like about nine songs with them. Mm-hmm. They put us on the shelf because the OJs were still relevant. Mm-hmm. Walter didn't like that. He didn't like that they were sitting us on the shelf. So he took us from there, from that situation. Now we don't have a record deal. But Gerald and them do. So Gerald and them was going on and being a Levert. And then Gerald went solo. But me and Gerald always stayed close. We always stayed real close.
Okay.
I was still trying to make it in the business. So when my group, we started singing background for Dennis Edwards.
Right.
The Temptations.
Temptations, yeah. Mm-hmm.
And we did that for about, we probably did that for 2 years, the group. But the other two guys was like, we're not background singers. We're not going to keep doing this for this little money. I'm gone. I'm not doing that. Me, on the other hand, I was like, I need to know. I need the knowledge.
Right.
That little $100 I was getting tonight, it didn't faze me. It wasn't even about the money. It was about Dennis. It was about Dennis. Dennis used to tell me stories and he used to teach me certain things. So Dennis kind of pulled me under his wings.
Yeah.
And he would just show me the ropes and he would tell me all, even when he was doing wrong, he would tell me the things not to do. You know what I mean?
Right.
Mm-hmm. So me and Dennis formed a bond. Now at this time, when Dennis went back to the temps, remember when they had the seven guys? When Dennis went back to the temps, I moved from Cleveland, moved to Detroit. And Mason at the time was managing UNV. Something's going on.
Yep, I remember that.
He was managing them, and he got them a deal with Madonna's label.
Okay.
So he had me come to Detroit. I formed a group where he put a group together called E&J, myself and a young lady named Jeannie Lyles. We was going to be an edgy version of Peaches and Herb.
All right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And so we started recording with Don Barton. And Don Barton had the cable company, but he formed a record label called Barton Records. And Kiera, Greg Charlie from Kiera, was producing us.
Mm-hmm.
Greg Charlie and David Lee Spradley from Parliament Funkadelic.
Yeah.
They were producing us.
Yeah.
So we was getting records. Now we got this little record deal. And and it stalled for a minute. And Gerald, I don't know how he always find me, but he always found me. He found me and he called me and said, Dad and them is holding auditions for the OJs. You need to get back home.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, for real? So I didn't want to leave Mason because Mason had spent all this money. And, and I told Mason, I was like, hey, man, Gerald called. He said, Eddie and them was holding auditions for the OJs, but I'm a shoe-in.
Mm-hmm.
Mason says, nothing else I can do for you here. You should go. I said, oh, man, I can't leave you, man. I can't leave you, man. You spent all this money, man. We got to see this thing through. He said, man, go. I came back to Cleveland. Never forget this. I came back to Cleveland. I had a suitcase in my trunk with my clothes in it. Mm-hmm. I went to the studio. Gerald was recording the Father and Son album.
Okay. Yep. I remember that.
So he told me, he said, come here. He said, I'm here every day. You come here every day. I'm going to get you some background work so you can get paid. He said, here. I said, well, I don't have a place to stay right now. He said, well, here. He gave me $300 and he said, go get your room for the night. So I'm looking at this $300 in my hand.
Yeah.
I said, for a night, what kind of room you staying in? I'm about to go over here. I'm about to go over to cross country.
Yeah.
Where it's $29 a night.
Yeah.
And they got HBO and they got Showtime. You know what I'm saying?
And you can get you a couple of hamburgers.
Talk to me, man. They had a microwave, they had a refrigerator, they had hot running water. I could take a shower. I was over there for 9 days, bro. Easy. Easy.
I hear you.
I don't know what room you gonna get for $300, but I ain't getting that room for $300. I'm gonna go over here and I'm still at the cross country inn. So that's what I did. And I came back there every day, and then Gerald paid me for the Father and Son.
Mm-hmm.
And because I was still recording now. I'm recording. Mm-hmm. I still ain't in the OJs.
Okay. All right.
I'm recording the Father and Son. Gerald gave me $1,600. I went and got an apartment. No furniture, no nothing. I had a mattress.
Yeah.
You know, whatever. And a TV, a little 19-inch TV.
Yeah.
All right. Jay's is holding audition. He's steady telling his dad, this is the one. This guy is the guy. He's the guy that should be in the OJs. Yeah, I know he's popular locally, but I don't think he's ready for the big time. Gerald said, Dad, I'm telling you, this is the guy.
Mm-hmm.
So I rehearsed with them a couple of times. They start putting together the Father and Son tour. And they needed somebody to do that third part, the middle part, when the OJs come out. Because Eddie and Gerald would come out, then the OJs, then Levert, and then we all come together and sing together, right? So that little 15 minutes, they needed somebody to fill that third position. And they was like, well, who are we going to get to fill that third position? So what I told Gerald in a meeting with his father and Reggie Levert, I said, I can do the backgrounds and come out as an OJ. And they said, well, how are you going to do that? I said, I can stay on there, sing. If you ever get the tape, if you ever see the CD or the tape, you'll see this. I'm singing backgrounds when the show first starts. I sneak off stage and I go and get dressed and I come out with the OJs. And then I come back out and Levert and the OJs do each other's songs. So we was doing 26 songs a night. I was doing 26 songs a night.
Dang.
And I put that work in so that I could do the backgrounds with Gerald and then sing with the OJs. So Eddie then was kind of like, okay. Yeah, he's doing the job, but how he's gonna do when he get with the old man and he got to retain 75 minutes. He retained the 15 minutes.
Yeah.
Now what is he gonna do when we get with Charlie Atkins and he got to retain 75 minutes? Mm-hmm. So we went to Las Vegas. We rehearsed 6 days a week for 3 months. I learned Charlie Atkins stuff in 2.5 months.
Charlie Atkins is a choreographer.
I'm sorry. Charlie Atkins is the choreographer. He's the one who did all of the choreography for the Motown group, the Temps to the Supremes.
All right.
You know, and he did and he taught them stage etiquette, taught them how to talk, how to walk on stage, how to come off stage, how to sit, how to give interviews. That Charlie Atkins, the world famous Charlie Atkins. And I learned all his stuff I kind of cheated a little bit too, because with Charlie, well, I ain't gonna say cheated. I'll just say I did my homework. When Charlie would tell us what the songs he was gonna rehearse the next day, I would get it. I asked Charlie for all his tapes, which I still have to this day. I asked him for all his tapes, and I would watch Sammy Strang, because I felt like Sammy Strang was the blueprint.
Okay.
I just don't feel like there was nobody better than Sammy Strang when it comes to choreography and showmanship on stage. Sammy Strang was my blueprint.
Okay.
So I would turn the TV catacorner and I would emulate what Sammy is doing. I knew I wasn't doing it correctly, but I knew I knew I had majority of the mechanics down.
Right.
So when I got to rehearsal the next day, Charlie would teach me the correct way to do it, but at least I was familiar with what I was supposed to be doing. So I would do that. I would rehearse 6 to 8 hours with the Jays, Monday through Saturday, but I would go to my apartment because they gave us apartments. So I'll go to my apartment and I rehearse another 2 or 3 hours. Because for me, Mr. Holmes, it was more like college.
Okay.
You know what I mean? In my head, it was college. Mm-hmm. Nothing else matters but these courses. Nothing else mattered to me but the lesson, but getting the work done. I could have fun after 4 years of college. I can get a job and, you know, but for these 4 years, I need to be here. You know what I mean? Sir. I need to be this focused. And so there was no playing around. There was no girls. There was no, I'm in Vegas. I wasn't even gambling like that. You know, it was strictly work for me, man. And I rest on Sundays. I watched football or basketball on Sundays. And it was just strictly, I just kept my head in the game the entire time. You know what I mean?
That's you know, that's that Michael Jordan kind of discipline, you know, that's what that is. When everybody else goes off the court, you stay on the court and you're still working.
Right. And that was important to me. That was more important to me. It was more important to me to get the lesson. It was more important to me to make sure that I could be I wasn't even trying to be the best. I think I was just trying to make sure that Sammy is that void that Sammy left was filled. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Now I'm gonna take you back up. I'm gonna bring you back. You were talking earlier about, you know, watching people like me doing what I do and you doing your radio show, how you like your radio. Just a warning for you. And I think you got a piece of it now. Just a warning for you. once you start doing this whole radio podcast thing, man, it's hard to let this stuff go, man.
I know, man. And I'm struggling with it right now. You know what I mean? I'm to the point to where I'm like trying to figure out how can I do it while I'm on the road.
Yeah, I know.
You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to figure out. They had this machine that they told me that I can log into when I'm on the road, and mm-hmm. I can do the show from my room, mm-hmm. and they'll just grab it from, you know, mm-hmm. they got some machine that does that, whatever. But I'm trying to figure out how I can do it with even being on the road. To this day, I'm trying to figure it out.
I know. Look, I've been in radio for like 36, 37 years. And this is the first time I'm saying this out loud. So I was working for a station before I started doing this. And it wasn't full time. It was part time. It's a nice station here. Actually, it's a Christian station. And I said to myself, the money that they pay me to do that. And I started doing research on this. I was like, I can make the same money, if not more, doing this. And I can just do it in my own studio. Mm. I don't have to go and stay, you know, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 hours. So I'm just saying, man, just be forewarned. I already see you already got it in your head. You're trying to figure out how you're going to make this work. That's the bug that I'm talking about. So you've already
been. I do, man. And I'm you know what? And I get excited every show.
Yeah.
I get excited to do it. I get excited to do every show. And like I told you earlier, it has filled such a void for me, mm-hmm. for not being on stage. It filled a void. It hasn't taken the place of me mm-hmm. actually being interacting with crowd. But yeah, I got the bug, and you know, Mason thinks it's funny, and I mm-hmm. see you laughing. So, you know, Mason thinks it's funny because him and I used to play. We used to uh-huh. play like DJs when we were kids.
Really? Because
Mason and I came up together. He actually used to be my bass player. And so we used to play DJ. We used to make up rhymes and stuff, you know what I'm saying, before he even thought about getting into radio. And now he's actually doing it on a whole nother level.
Yeah.
And you're right. You're absolutely correct, man. Your forewarning is...
Yeah. Wow. So, I'm just telling you. And the way that things are now, it's so convenient. You know, what I'm doing now in my studio back in the day, it would have taken up a whole, 12 by 12 room or something like that to have all of the equipment in there just to make all of this happen. Now you got software, you got a microphone, it'll work. So, you know, I wish you the best of luck. Stick with it. Do it. So now let's talk about the OJs just a fraction more. So since COVID has hit, you're filling the void. Do you guys plan on going back on the road anytime soon, or what? Because I know you've already told me you're missing it. You're missing the road and being on stage. And I can imagine so. What about Walter and Eddie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're trying to get back on the road very soon. The hiccup right now is Eddie wants to do a tour with tour buses, and he wants to go out for 2 to 3 months straight. He don't want to come back. He don't, you know, like these last couple of years, we've been doing one off, two off, three off. So, you know, we'll go out, we'll fly here and we'll fly there, mm-hmm. and we'll do weekends and we'll come back home. Mm-hmm. Eddie doesn't want to come back home. He wants to go out for the next 2 or 3 months, take tour buses out, do these weekend dates, you know, the Thursday, Friday, and Saturdays, the Friday, Saturdays, and Sundays, and then pick up dates like maybe at casinos here and there on Tuesdays and Wednesdays or Wednesdays and Thursdays. You know what I mean? But they're trying to strategically put that together now. That's the length. And neither one of them, more so Eddie now, before it was Walt, but now it's more so Eddie, don't want to fly.
Okay.
They don't want to fly because of the COVID and all that.
Yeah, yeah.
They don't want to fly. They just want to do tour buses and go out. And then he wants to do the 3 months and then take a break. Okay. You know, on a vacation somewhere or whatever, you know, he wants to just take a break and then come back and do another 3 or 4 months.
Have you guys ever done that before?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Way before COVID.
Okay.
Yeah. We would go out, man. I would go out and I wouldn't see home for 5 months.
Wow.
We'd just be out, man. And then the days when we'd be off, we wind up in some city that I probably can't even pronounce the name.
Yeah.
And we just chill there for 2 or 3 days. And then we hit the road again. Al Haymon at the time, Al Haymon did one of our last big tours. Right before he went into boxing. He did the World Greatest Singing Group tour with us, the Whispers, Temptations, and Four Tops. And we probably went out that last tour. We probably went out for 2 months, 2.5 months. So I've done them. When I first got in a group, that's what we were doing. We were doing tours.
All right. What? Here's one for you. Just out of the blue. I'm gonna throw these out there at you every now and again. What is your favorite OJ song?
Just Let Me Make Love to You.
Why?
Yeah. And my second would probably be Love You to Tears. Off the Love You to Tears album, but just let me make love to you.
Why that one? Why is that your favorite song?
I think just the passion that Eddie had in that song.
Okay.
Just the passion. I think because, I mean, you know, Eddie sings with passion anyway.
He does.
Because that was all Eddie, and that was the early Eddie, and for him to put that kind of emotion in that song and what the song was saying, the lyrics that was what it was saying, it was just all it, That's the true essence of a love song.
Yeah.
That's the true essence. If you ever want to have a gauge, if you want to gauge a love song, there's a lot of slow songs. Even some songs, Ronald Isley does it best. He does some of the best love songs. You know what I mean? Whisper does some of the best love songs. Because, I mean, some of the best love songs. Whisper's Isley Brothers, hands down. When it comes to consistency. But that Just Let Me Make Love to You had all the ingredients to me. It had the passion, it had the vocals, it had the emotions, and it had the lyrics. And then the music never, if you notice, the music never overpowered the vocals. It never had to go, dun, 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 dun. It never had to do none of that. That's my favorite OJ song.
Wow. What is your favorite routine on stage?
For the Love of Money.
Okay.
For the Love of Money. That's probably because I spent the most time on trying to learn that choreography. that gave me the blues. That song, and when we did, and I'm glad you asked that, because that song and a song entitled Keep On Loving Me, what me and Eddie used to do to that song, Walt was the lead, and me and Eddie were doing the choreography. What we used to do to that song would get us damn near standing ovations.
Really?
Choreography, yes.
Okay.
The choreography, it got so bad. We was getting so many screens of holler on just the choreography alone that Walt started, like, while me and Eddie was doing it, Walt would come and get in between us and sing because he felt like nobody was paying attention to him singing.
He feeling left out. He feeling some kind of way, huh? It's like spotlight's supposed to be on
me. Yeah, right. And me and Eddie was killing that song. If you ever can find that on YouTube, Keep On Loving Me. What we used to do to that song, it was a shame before God. It was a shame before God, man. It was a shame. That and for the love of money, because the choreography we're doing for the love of money is priceless.
Okay. All right. I'm gonna have to check that out. I'm gonna have to check it out. So let's talk about Eric Nolan. Man, you've got some interesting stuff going on with you.
Mm-hmm.
Matter of fact, one of your projects or a part of your project or a piece of your project. I had the, if I want to say that, I had the opportunity to interview him a couple of weeks ago. I think you had a lot to do with him being where he is, and that's Lavelle.
Lavelle Browning.
Yeah, Lavelle Browning. And you've, I think you had something to do with him and his group at the time called G-Man, correct?
Right. Well, yeah. That's okay. The group that he was in.
Right.
But
right.
That was a group that I put together.
Okay.
It wasn't like a group that he came with. I handpicked these guys.
Okay. All right.
And what happened was I had an idea to create the next singing group. Actual mm-hmm. singing group that could sing.
Mm-hmm.
And I started looking for guys. I found a guy here in Cleveland by the name of Johnny Youngblood. Mm-hmm. And he had a gritty, soulful voice like Bobby Womack.
Yep.
I was like, yeah, okay, yeah. I need one of them. I need one of them David Ruffin, Bobby Womack type voices in this group.
Yeah.
But now I need somebody who could sing pretty. I need somebody who could sing a pretty tenor. And then I went on YouTube and I started looking at all kind of people. And I found this guy named Andy Pierre.
Mm-hmm.
And he was in Miami, Florida, by way of Dayton. He's born in Dayton, Ohio, but he was living in Miami, Florida. So I got in touch mm-hmm. with him through, I got in touch with him through YouTube and wow. gave him an idea to see wow. if he was interested. So he was interested.
Mm-hmm.
So I was doing a show. The OJs, Howard Hewitt, and Lavelle.
Mm.
Lavelle opened up the show. It was in Augusta, Georgia.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And I heard this kid singing, man. And I said, that's what I need that. That's the next best thing to having Kevon Edmonds. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yes, sir. I mean, yes, sir.
I'm like, with that power too, I was like, call my nephew. With who's really actually who produces and writes it for all of us.
Uh-huh.
Jay Sean, you got to hear this. And I put him up to the phone while Lavelle was on stage singing. And, mm-hmm. and Jay Sean said, yeah, that's what we need. Get him up. And so after the show, I went and talked to him. At the time, Lavelle had a manager or a guy that was acting as manager. And I told Lavelle my idea. Lavelle loved the idea. He said, I'll come. I brought all those three guys in. The same day I brought them in was the same day they recorded. The same day they sung together. The same day they blended. The same day they was able to hear two songs that they cut. We cut two songs on them the day they got in Cleveland.
So they never sang together. Ever. They didn't even know each other.
They didn't even know each other. Dang. It was just all on an idea that I had.
Okay.
And I sold them on this idea of this group because it was supposed to be five guys. I was mm-hmm. going to call them the Gentlemen.
Okay.
That was going to be the name of the group, the Gentlemen. And I had these five guys, but I knew I had to have at least three that could sing. I'll get the mm-hmm. other two guys. Let's mm-hmm. just cut mm-hmm. these three guys. And after that, I remember taking them to a club and they were singing. Each one of them was singing individually and stuff like this. And I was telling this guy, his name is Robert Cruz. And I said, yeah, man, I just got to find two other guys, man. You know what I'm saying? Because I'm trying to put together this five-man group. And he said, why? Hmm. Why? That's the group right there.
Mm-hmm.
He said, that's the next best thing to the OJs. I said, I'm keeping them like that. So because I thought I felt the name was too long.
Okay.
The Gentlemen, I cut it down to G-Men.
Okay. Got it.
You know what I mean? So then we just focused on them. We must have cut about. Not exaggerating, we probably cut about 14 songs on those guys. I got 14 songs on G-Man, And I promise you, out of the 14, 10 of my singles.
Really?
10 of my timeless singles. I could release them today.
Dang.
I got 10 songs on them guys that's timeless singles. Lavelle will tell you. He got them all. He got all the records.
Wow.
So by me putting them in touch with, bringing them in,
mm-hmm.
and him and Jay Sean formed a bond, and Jay Sean likes recording him because basically whatever he tells, whatever Jay Sean tells Lavelle to sing, Lavelle can sing it.
He can do it. Okay.
Whatever.
Okay.
It don't matter. Jay yeah. Sean will snatch something out the tree and say, yeah. do this. And Lavelle can do it.
He can
Lavelle,
do it.
Lavelle that cold. He's that talented.
He is good now.
He's Mr. Holmes. you don't hear me. Lavelle is incredible. Lavelle okay. is incredible. And what's making it so good is that all three of the guys were incredible. None of them were good.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They were all incredible. Andy Pierre incredible. Was like, Andy Pierre was an angel. He was the next best thing I ever heard of Eddie Kendricks.
Wow.
It is.
I did hear him. I just before we started the recording, I did hear him before you came on. I was listening to him. So yeah. You're right about Eddie Kendricks.
Oh yeah, man.
Correct. You're correct.
He does that like wake up out of sleep and do it. So I knew what I put together. I knew I had put together a super group.
Mm-hmm.
My thing mm-hmm. was I couldn't get a distribution deal.
Mm.
I had a hard time. I had some people that wanted to give me a distribution deal, but it was those kind of like rookie contract, rookie things or whatever. It just wasn't what I needed for the group. I needed them to be put on the radio. I don't need you to put me on Amazon, Spotify. I can do that myself.
Yeah.
I don't need you to cut no videos. I can do that myself.
Right.
I didn't get the clothes myself. I can cut them myself. I own my own recording studio.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Right. Yes, sir. Yes,
so
sir.
Putting Lavelle in touch with Jay Sean, and I remember Lavelle saying, I don't want to lead the group. I said, Lavelle, there's nothing I can do for you right now because
mm-hmm.
I don't have a distribution deal. In order for G-Men to be reckoned with in the business, I need a distribution deal that can simultaneously drop those records on the radio at one time.
So hold that thought. So what you said to him is the same thing that someone else said to you some years back. So, okay. Yeah. So they told you the same. You said, and look, I don't want to leave, but he said, I can't do nothing else for you. And you told Lavelle the same thing.
I said, Lavelle, there's a reason why I didn't put you on the contract. You know, everybody else was saying, lock them down.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you got to lock them down, man. Somebody going to steal them. Mm-mm. I believe in the honor system. I believe that those guys love me and I love them. And I mm-hmm. knew they felt the love from me. You know what I mean? So I knew Lavelle had a genuine love for me.
Mm.
And in return, I have a genuine love for Lavelle. So what mm-hmm. I did with Lavelle, I said, Lavelle, it's the reason why I didn't lock you down to a contract. Because the major goal here was for you to be successful in the music business.
Right, right.
Doing what you love to do. I lock you down. They got to deal with me to get you.
Right.
And when they deal with me to get you and they pay me to get you, you got to pay them back.
That's true.
You got to pay them. They got to get their money back. And then they're going to tax interest on your money that they paid me mm-hmm. to get you.
Mm-hmm.
So that's not the goal here. The goal here is for you to make it in the business. I'm already doing what I love to do. I'm with the OJs.
Mm-hmm.
I'm already getting a check. I'm already doing decent. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So if I never record another record, I'm cool. You know what I mean?
Right. Right.
I've done some things. I had some fun.
Yeah.
And you know, but so Lavelle and Jay Sean just kept working together. And I told him to go out there and do it. Go out there. I told all three of them the same thing. Go out there and do that. Explore that.
Mm-hmm.
Lavelle just stayed with Jay Sean.
Mm.
He just stayed coming back to Jay Sean because he liked the way Jay Sean recorded him and the mm-hmm. records Jay Sean was giving him.
Mm-hmm.
So he stayed close to home.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Right. Well, the other guys, when I said, go do what you need to do, they went somewhere else to try to do some other things. But Lavelle stayed here. So Jay Sean just kept on pumping out, smashing. Every song that Jay Sean did on Lavelle was a hit. It wasn't a hit record, like, you know, selling wise, but
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
it was a good single. And then mm-hmm. he did that song, that he did with Anthony Hamilton.
Fell in Love.
Fell in Love. When he did that song, Fell in Love, Lavelle had already cut that track. He'd already did that record. It was done. Mm-hmm. It was getting ready to get mixed.
Wow.
And I think Joe had came up with the idea of putting somebody else on that record, which was a perfect idea and the perfect person. You know what I mean? You got Anthony. Anthony is a throwback from us. I mean, we've done shows with Anthony, and Anthony just come and just sit in our dressing room and just chill and kick it with us.
Yeah.
I mean, that's how he is. That's the kind of spirit Anthony has, a realistic spirit, mm-hmm. if that makes sense to you.
Yeah, it does. It does.
You know what I'm saying? He doesn't feed into the Hollywood version or the star version of being a star. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Yes, sir.
He think he does good records. He think he does records that people would like.
Mm-hmm.
But that don't define who he is.
Mm-hmm.
He's just a guy. He's just a dude, man. Anthony Hamilton is like probably one of the most down-to-earth guys I ever met, besides Otis Williams of the Temptations.
Really?
Otis Williams of the Temptations. Otis Williams of the Temptations, probably one of the most down-to-earth cats I've along with Scotty and Walt from The Whispers. But he's one of the most down-to-earth. Let me switch channels for 1 second.
Go,
let me
go ahead. Switch, okay?
Just 1 second.
Go ahead.
When I first got with the Jays, and I still do it to this day, but back then I was always in the wings of watching other groups perform.
All right.
I was still learning. I'm still in school at this point. You know, that's how I feel. I'm always in school.
Yes, sir.
And we went out with the Temps. And I never forget this, man. I said, Otis Williams came in with a nice black outfit. It was beautiful. Oh, it was cut on him. It was sleek. It was just real cool. It wasn't flashy. So I said, Mr. Williams, I love that outfit. He said, this right here? I said, man, I love that outfit. What size you wear? At the time, I think I was wearing a 32. Okay. 30 or something. I told him what I wore. Came back to the show the next day. He had it in a box and he gave it to me. So he went and bought it from me. We was in New York. I'll never forget where we was at. We was in New York. He went and physically went himself and bought it and gave it to me.
Really?
Never forget as long as I live.
Wow.
Never forget that as long as I live, man. I mean, and to this day, I mean, even when he came to Cleveland like about a month and a half ago, he called me. He said, man, look, I'm looking for a lead singer, man. What you got for me? And I brought him a guy down there, and he liked the guy. The guy just didn't follow up. But that's who he is. He's just really, really down to earth. And that's how Anthony is. Anthony is a throwback. He don't feed into the other stuff. You know, so him being with Lavelle, that's perfect, man. That's perfect.
Yeah. It's perfect. A nice song. It's a beautiful song, man. And I love what both of them add to. You know, it's like Lavelle comes in with his smoothness and he sets him up. And then Anthony comes in with his raspiness and kind of knocks him down, and he adds that accent in there and he does what he does. And I think it's a perfect combination. That's just it.
And that's what Lavelle would do with G-Men. And G-Men, it was the same thing. We had Johnny Youngblood, who had the rough, rugged voice, and they would trade on, and we would have them trading off like that. And Johnny Youngblood would take it here, and Lavelle would snatch it from here, and he would take it there. Oh man, I got smashes on these guys, man. I'm telling you the truth. I got smashes on, and I put together another group called Nahami and Billy Rich. I got Nahami off of YouTube too.
All right.
But I knew she was trying to be a solo artist. And I said, well, look, it's all about packaging. You can still be a solo artist, but let me package you. So I put three guys with her. And made them like a modern day Gladys Knight and the Pips. Yeah.
Okay. All right.
And then I came up with like me and Jay Sean, we were just trying to come up with a tough name, a tough but classy name for them. And Billy is always tough. You know what I mean? I don't care who it is. His name is William, but if you say Billy, you think of a tough boy. You know what I'm saying? And Rich is classy. Rich is classy by himself.
Yeah, that's true.
So I put them together.
At it, but you're right. But you're right.
I do all this stuff, man. I do all this stuff in my sleep. I don't. And when I'm in Cleveland, I don't rest. Mm-hmm. Go to sleep, mm-hmm. but I don't rest.
You know what? This is probably one of my top interviews that I've done. I kid you not, man. I enjoy this in talking to you, because as you're telling the story, you paint the picture, and I could see as you're painting everything that you're saying, and I'm like, wow, this is interesting. This is interesting. It's I love it. So now let's get back to Eric Nolan and his project. Mm-hmm. So reminds me of you. In my life, man, those are some singles that people need to hear. Reminds me of you. I heard that all in my sleep last night. And your voice is so familiar. It's like I've heard this song before, and it's your voice. You've got that unique voice. Oh, let me ask you this real quick. I said, I'm going to ask him this question, and I hope he don't shoot me. Let me ask you this question. If I missed it somewhere down the line, tell me, lest you're wrong, it did happen. But have you ever being on stage, and we're going to come back to your project. Have you ever been on stage with Walter and Eddie, and they're singing their songs, they're leading and everything? Have you ever wanted to snatch the mic and say, or push them to the side and say, look, I'm leading this song? Have you ever wanted to do that?
Nope.
Okay.
Never. Never. And I never thought about it. I think because I know, because I've seen them do it nightly. Mm-hmm. I know I'm with two of the best that ever did it.
There you go.
I don't consider myself as the best that ever did it. But okay. I do consider them the best that ever did it. You know what I mean? And yes, I've been around, again, I say these people's name, you know, with great respect. I've been around the Ronald Isleys. I've been around the Whispers. I've been around Dennis Edwards. I've been around, you know, I've been around, you know, the Dramatics, LJ Reynolds, and I've been around some of the Gerald Austin, who I think is one of the greatest, yeah, period. Yeah. I mean, from the Manhattans. I mean, I've been around these people, Patti LaBelle. I've been around these people. I've seen what they do. And I think the only ones that I could put up there with them is Patti, Gladys, LJ, some nights, but Gerald Austin definitely. But Eddie and Walter Williams, Eddie Levert and Walter Williams are two of the best I've ever seen do it. I've never thought about it once, not even one time. I've never even thought about saying, you know, man, y'all need to let me sing.
Really?
Never thought about it. No, I consider myself as being BJ Armstrong.
Okay.
When I'm with them.
Okay.
I can shoot. I can make layups.
Yeah.
I can dribble. I can do all of that. I can do everything you can do. Mm-hmm. But you're great at it.
That's fair. That's fair.
I can get you 16.
Yeah.
But you can get me 36 at any given night.
You know what I look at that is this. I listen to you. And trust me, I pondered asking you this question ever since this interview, even knowing that I was going to interview you, mm-hmm, probably about a month or so ago, I pondered asking you that question. And the way you answered the question is so humbling. And I look at it like this. It's like you just said. The thing of it is that you can do it. Mm-hmm. But they're great at it. So my takeaway is, know your lane and stay in your lane.
There it is. There it is.
You know, that's my takeaway. And I look at some groups that were together and they fall out because somebody else is getting more shine than the other one. They thought somebody else is getting more money. The record company came and offered somebody some more. That whole jealousy thing, that whole thing. And then they tried to do a solo career. They tried to do this other kind of career at this, you know, and it just didn't work out. It just didn't catch like if they would have stayed together. And I look at that and I say, you stay in your lane. And we actually work better together mm-hmm. than we do apart.
Yes.
And once we understand that that's who and what we are, we're good. We are great as a team.
I've yet once to see barbecue being good without the sauce. Barbecue can be good now.
Yeah.
It can be good. You can season it and it can be good.
Yeah.
But that sauce is boss.
That's okay.
That sauce is boss.
I'm from Texas, so you know, okay. I'm not gonna argue boss. With you.
It no, is. I'm just saying we've seen the likes of Eddie Levert sing a song from the beginning to the end and how great he could be doing that song.
Yeah.
But he got to be great for 75 minutes.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm with you. I got you.
Walter Williams got to be great for 75 minutes.
Yeah.
So Eddie Levert told me this maybe 15, 20 years ago. I never forgot it when he told me. He said, find your window and stay in your window. Everybody got a window. Mm-hmm. Don't do nothing more, nothing less. Create your window. And when you said earlier, you said you got a sound I heard before, but it's unique. And I do know I have a sound because I don't feel like my tone is that great. You know what I mean?
Okay.
And when I say that, because I think I think what I'm doing is I have a tendency of comparing it to the tones of people that I like.
Okay.
And because I like them and I digest them as being great, or I mm-hmm. digest them as being, you know, a phenomenal tone and what he can do with his voice, I feel like I come beneath that. Mm. But the thing that I know that I have in my favor, if it is a favor, when I get a hit record, then I'll tell you it's in my favor. What I think is in my favor is that in my head, I call myself Mr. Melody because I sing melodies. I came up in the 60s and 70s where groups were just doing melodies. They weren't doing a whole lot of riffs and runs. They were singing mm-hmm. songs. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And so mm-hmm. I know that I can finesse a song. I know that about myself. I know I can finesse a song. I know I can sing a melody of a song. Mm-hmm. I know especially as long as I got Jay Sean Champion, you know, right here in the core, I'm going to mm-hmm. always be able to do meaningful records, and I'm going to always be able to do records that are records. I'm going to always be able to do a record. You know what I mean? Not just a song, but I do songs that can be played on the radio like right now. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. See what I'm saying? So stuff like Reminds Me is basically just a thought. I'm in the mall. I saw a dress. Remind me of my girl. I saw a movie she wanted to see. Remind me of her. Then she liked Jelly Bellies. So I saw some Jelly Bellies. I was like, told Jay Sean, said, everything I seen today remind me of my girl. He said, that's a record. He said, everything in this world that's good reminds me of you.
Mm.
And we cut that record. On my way, in my life, I miss you. So then I start saying, Jay Sean, well, I think I want my moniker to be, what I want my kind of little image to be, is that I'm going to say the things that that women want to hear guys say, but guys don't never say them, or they don't say them, or they feel like it's making them too soft to say it.
True.
So I say, I'll say it. Mm-hmm. And I'll make it cool. I'll make it cool to say it. You know what I mean? I'll make it cool. Sir. I mean, because let's keep it all the way to 100, Mr. Holmes. Let me tell you this part.
Go ahead.
I am I'm a street guy. Okay. I'm a product of the streets. I'm not a thug.
Yeah, yeah.
Thug is thug his ways. I have some thuggish tendencies, you know what I mean? But I'm not a thug. I'm not a thug. Just get that through. So they can't. So if they ever hear this, they can't take that excerpt and say, "Oh, he says he's a thug." No, I'm not a thug. You know what I'm saying? I am a product of the streets. I did my little stuff. You know what I mean? You know, the stuff that makes you grow up.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
That's the stuff that makes you grow up to be a man. That's stuff that makes you say, "Okay, I don't want to do that," or right. "That I didn't did that," or "That ain't right. where it's at." That kind of stuff.
Right.
So,
right.
So I play ball and all that kind of stuff. You know, I did my little stuff in the strip clubs and stuff like this. So I hear how dudes talk. I hear how they talk about their woman. I hear how they talk about females. I ain't saying that, man. That's soft, man. I ain't doing that, man. I ain't saying like that, man. She want me to say it, but I ain't saying it.
Right.
I say it.
Yeah.
I got a little bit of street cred. I say it.
Yeah.
So y'all won't have to be so soft.
Right.
Just put the record on.
I'm doing this for you. I'm helping you out.
Put the record on. You gotta listen to this.
There you go.
Yeah, man. So I'm trying to find my window.
Okay.
I'm trying to find my window, Mr. Holmes. And so as soon as I find my window, I think I'm creating it. I'm creating it now. Mm-hmm. I just gotta stay. As I always say, I'm throwing jabs. I'm in the seventh round. I still got 12 rounds. You know what I mean?
Yes.
I'm a jab before a little while, before this knockout comes. Okay. And I just think that in time, I saw Johnny Gill do this once. He put out a record. And it just looked like the record wasn't going to be no hit. It just didn't look like it was going to happen. Mm-hmm. And then 2 years later, the record happened. Mm-hmm. 2 years later. And see, that's where the business is now. The business is where it may not happen right then, but because of social media and people always, looking and searching and listening, and they grab hold of something. Radio got up off of it 6 weeks. You know, they did 6 weeks, they did 6 to 8 weeks, and they got up off the record.
That's true. That's true.
Right?
That's what they do.
That's
what they do.
But because of people always surfing, they find something, they gravitate, and they grab hold to it. So I'm hopeful. Reminds me, a lady called me like about 3 months ago and told me she was in Dominican Republic. And they was dancing to Reminds Me. I said, "You kidding?" Wow. She said, "Listen." She said, "The DJ is playing Reminds Me." This was 3 months ago.
Yeah.
I put that record out in 14.
Yeah. Yeah. I don't know. I was looking. Yeah.
See what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
On my way. Jay Sean predicted on my way. He said, we gotta make them dance. He said, "We gotta make them dance."
Mm-hmm.
So that's why we did On My Way. I had a different story for On My Way because we both was writing the record. We both came up with the hook. We was writing the record. My thing was my girl was leaving me because I was on the road so much. So I'm on my way home to mend that relationship.
Mm-hmm.
Jay Sean made it a good time. I liked his I liked his version better.
Okay.
He made it, "I'm on my way to pick you up and take you out for a good time. And I know you picky about where you want to go and what you eat, stuff like this. So this is all about you. Whatever you want to do, I'm on my way to get you so we can go do that." And his way was just fun. It was like, that's what women like, for you to pay attention to them.
That's true.
"I miss you in my life." In my life is just basically how she makes me feel in my life, the things that she do in my life that makes me feel. And we don't get a chance to say that, man. So I'm just trying to find my window. That's all. Just trying to find my window.
Well, man, you working on it. I think you got it, but it's your story. So,
it's my story.
Yeah, it's your story.
No, it's my bank account. My bank account ain't said it yet. Songs are good. The bank don't know about it yet, though. Who does the bank know? I can tell you.
As soon as the bank
knows about the song, Oh yeah, you the guy that made On My Way. Yeah. I'm that guy.
Oh, God. Oh,
hey, man. I'm sorry, man.
That's all right. That's all right. This is awesome, man. I'm loving this. I am loving this. But, man, look, this has been great, man. This has been great. Man, I appreciate you hanging out with me, man. It's been a good time. Please stay in touch, man.
Mr. Holmes, you got me. You got me 24/7. If your listeners, if they decide they like this interview, I got some part twos and threes left for you, bro. Okay. Okay. I got some stuff for you now. I got some stuff for you now. I got some stuff, man. Look like Gerald. The first time I did, and I know we about to leave, but
no, Gerald, go ahead.
Gerald, the very first time I did the Essence Festival, mm-hmm. 86,000 people. Since mm-hmm. then, I've done things for 100,000, 200,000, but the very first time I did, never did anything that big before. And mm-hmm. so I'm telling Gerald, hey man, what do? When you perform in front of 86,000 people, I never did this before. What do, Gerald? And he was like, you just make everything bigger, he said. Mm. And I'm digesting it like, do I wave my hands bigger? Do I, you know, what do I do bigger? How do I become bigger than what I am? Uh-huh. So I get on stage and we performing and we getting ready to do Full Love Money. So I'm trying to overdo all my choreography. I'm just overdoing it. I'm just, you know, because I don't know what I'm doing, man. So I'm just doing it. And man, I took a bit and I guess my legs went too far apart and I did this split and I was out on the floor, man. And so I was like, oh, Gerald was back there cracking up. And when I got off stage, he was like, that's not what I was talking about. Yeah, but what are you talking about? Make it bigger. Never understood what that meant, man.
You never understood it? Hey.
I ain't understood what making it bigger mean. I thought he meant like making all my steps bigger, make my I don't know, man. But I guess what he was saying was make your presence bigger.
Okay.
Command on the stage. Own it. Make that bigger. You know what I mean? Don't keep it in the club. Don't keep your act in a 3,000 seater or you know, 1,500 seater. Make your presence bigger. If you notice, whenever you saw Gerald, and I know you did it, and everybody do it because they always say it to me, I thought he was bigger than what he was.
Mm.
I thought he was taller than what he was.
Mm-hmm.
And now I get it now. Mm-hmm. Because they tell me that. I thought you was taller than that. I see you on stage, you just seem taller.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's the presence.
Yeah, you look on stage. You look like you 6'6", 6'7", 6'10".
See what I'm saying?
Yeah,
because you make your presence bigger, and that comes with. And I used to see Eddie Levert do it. Eddie Levert was one of the best I ever seen do it. He could walk across. We was doing a show with Charlie Wilson one time. Charlie was just killing him because he came on first. He was just killing him. I said, Eddie, Charlie is killing him. He said, young fella, watch what I do.
Hmm.
I'm finessing that. And he finessed it. And he walked across that stage. He was holding that mic and he just got big. Eddie just got big right in front of my eyes. He just, wow. I mean, his body just covered the entire stage. That aura, man. It's nothing like it. And Charlie does it to this day. Charlie's really good at it now.
Yeah. Yeah.
He's really good at it. He's really good at it. Those people, man, that's what Gerald meant when he said make it bigger. I thought he said the step. I didn't slip on stage. I just did a split, unauthorized split. I didn't authorize that split. Okay, man, that ain't gonna take up all your time. that wasn't in my plan.
Man, it's all good, man. Look, I appreciate you coming back. Definitely. Okay. You're coming back. I promise you, you're coming. You got to come back for me. I don't care about you. You're coming back for me.
I come back for you, bro.
But look, if you guys need to find out what's going on with Eric Nolan, look, there is his website right there. It's ericsrooms.net. All of the information is all right there. Just check him out. And also, there's his Facebook. It's Eric Nolan. And on IG, it's I Am Eric Nolan.
Yes, sir. Instagram. Am I allowed to tell him about my radio show?
You sure can. Absolutely.
Can I?
Yeah.
Just check me out, y'all, on WOVU 95.9 FM, Cleveland, Ohio. Tens, the Eric Nolan Show. Every Sunday night at 8 o'clock, I do a For Lovers Only segment that I call For the Lover in You. And Drive Time on Mondays and Tuesdays at 3 p.m. Eastern Time. It's a fun show. So, I mean, if y'all could just check me out, it'd be much appreciated. Because I already got the bug. Mr. Holmes already know I got the bug. I got the bug. I need to tell y'all this. I got the bug, y'all.
You got it. Man, look, thanks again for stopping by. You're more than welcome anytime to come back through, man. I appreciate you so much for taking time out with me. And again, one more shout out to my friends over at Never Stop Entertainment, Miriam Graham. And also, again, this show has been powered by Dare to Be Different 601 Apparel. So make sure you check them out. Dare to Be Different 601 Apparel. Man, again, when you come back through Houston, you're on your way. Man, pick up the phone. Give me a call. Let me know.
I promise.
I'll get you some good barbecue or whatever it is you like to eat or whatever.
Oh, yeah, yeah. Y'all got some great restaurants down there, man. I've been to a lot of them. Great restaurants.
Okay, we'll go to it. It'll be my treat while you're working on your window. It'll be my treat.
I'll work on my window. Yeah, thank you. Thank you.
I'm just playing.
Thank you very much. Let me work on my window.
All right, brother. Peace. Appreciate you, man.
Take care of yourself, Mr. Holmes.
All right.
All right, bye.